and welcome to Off the Record Live. I'm Joe Vito for American Songwriter, and thank you for joining us on our new Twitch channel. Before we even dive into the episode today, before I even mention Tyler Farr's name, which I just did, I want to talk about the fact that we're at 517 subscribers right now. We're trying to hit 530. I think there's going to be a fun graphic on the screen at some point that's going to be talking about this. It's like beneath me, right down here, and you'll be able to see our progress. But we're getting to 530, so if you haven't subscribed yet, please subscribe. Please send it to your friends who like music. We love you all's support. That's how we make this happen. Welcome to Off the Record Live. Today, as I mentioned, we have Tyler Farr. How are you doing, Tyler?
Doing good. How you doing?
I'm doing really good. So Tyler, you recently had Cover Girl, which is a single that came out in June, and you're working on some cool stuff. And so we're really excited to have you here kind of speaking with us. And just to give everybody kind of a little overview, we're going to start with some icebreakers and then dive in, learn a little bit about your story. We're going to hear some live music. We're going to talk a bit about new stuff you're working on. And the whole time, you at home, if you got a question, you can ask the question. And we'll ask it to Tyler live on air. We got Michael, our wonderful producer in the back. He's watching it. I got it here on this little computer. I'm watching it. So if you got questions, let us know. Let's play some icebreakers.
Let's do it.
We're going to get to know Tyler. The first question is how you start your day. What's your morning routine?
Grumpy is like a grizzly bear that just got woken up in his cave. That's usually how I start. It's good to stay about 10 feet back every morning. If you don't believe me, ask my wife. But no, I usually drink a little bit of coffee, not too much, but I'm pretty simple, to be honest. I mean, I usually chug a water, drink a little coffee, and I chew tobacco, so I do that, unfortunately. It's a nasty habit, but that's what I do. And go to my back porch.
Does it make the grizzly bear go away?
No, the grizzly bear's with me.
Oh, there we go.
At all times.
All right. Oh my God. What time do you usually wake up?
Well, nowadays, since I have a 8-month-year-old, my first child, 5 a.m. to 6 to 4. I mean, it's early. Earlier than before when I had a
when I had calls.
That's right.
Well, what time of the day, if it's not right when you wake up, what time of the day are you most productive?
Probably afternoon, like noon and onward, probably. But it just depends what time I wake up. So if I wake up real early, I usually have a 4 hour of productiveness. That's it. That's all I got to offer.
4 minutes.
I just 4 hours and that's all you get.
All you get. You're getting a lot done in those 4 hours.
That's why I got to get it done quick, because after it's gone, I'm just worthless.
I can't do anything. Oh my gosh. Texting or calling?
Definitely calling. I absolutely hate long text messages. If I have to scroll down to read your text, over. I just don't even look at it.
Don't. So if you're sending messages to Tyler, do not make them too long.
If they look like the Dead Sea Scrolls, they will not be read.
Oh my gosh. Well, I think you answered our next question, which is, do you like to use emojis? It sounds like you're not a big texting fan at all. Do you use emojis if you do text?
Actually, I don't mind. I use like one emoji, and that's a thumbs up. That's
thumbs
it.
Thumbs up. What
and
else do
and
you
the
need?
Reasoning behind that is because I don't like texting a lot.
Oh.
And so I just go bam, bam, like cool.
Oh, and then you don't even have to text at all. You don't even have to say a single word. You can... Oh my gosh.
There you Genius, go. Huh?
Yes. Wow. Well, okay. Well, we're keeping things on the theme of little words. If you had to describe yourself in 3 words, what would they be?
Pretty dang simple.
Pretty dang simple?
Or...
3 words is too many words.
Yeah, I was just going to say... Just a country dude that likes to hang out and keep things as easy as possible.
There you go. Oh my gosh.
That's not three words, but whatever. Who's counting?
I feel like
this is our show. We can do whatever we want.
Yeah, we can make it as many words. That's absolutely correct. All right. You're going into a deli. What's your sandwich order?
My sandwich
order.
Order?
Like if you're going to order a sandwich, what kind of sandwich do you like?
Probably like a turkey. Maybe turkey, bacon, lettuce, tomato. I'm very simple, so there's not a whole, I'm like, all right, just give me the number four. That's a hard question because it depends on what deli you're going into.
That's true. Do you have like a favorite sandwich spot?
Like, I would say Firehouse is pretty strong. Mm-hmm. Jersey Mike's probably.
Mm-hmm.
Not a Jimmy John's guy, Jersey Mike's.
Understandable. The Jersey Mike's, they know what they're doing. Absolutely.
They do.
What was the first music you ever bought? Whether that was like a CD or like a record or like a single, like what was it?
I want to say it was probably a Boyz II Men Greatest Hits album from Seventh Heaven.
All right.
Like when you actually walked into a store and bought a disc and you put the disc into your player in your vehicle back before everything got all complicated and there's this and that going on. And back when people used to buy albums, back when we used to make money doing this.
We're on Twitch, and so some folks might not know that how it used to be.
Yeah, you used to, like, they actually bought the whole album. And you had a copy of it. You could open it up. Had cool pictures in it. Had the lyrics.
Oh, yeah. And you were a Boyz II Men fan? How old were you when you bought the record, you think?
I want to say probably 7th, 8th grade. That's when I started my journey and discovered girls.
Started with Boyz II Men.
Well, when girls come into play and you're like, oh, she's hot, and that's all that's on your mind is like football, baseball, basketball, and girls. It's like that, all the sports and girls. And then, so you start liking chicks, and then, well, Boyz II Men, I mean, that's what, when girls are involved, that's just what you listen to.
Chick liking music.
You just turn your black light on, put your glow in the dark stars up there, and
oh my gosh, that's very romantic. That's awesome.
I mean, throw a little incense.
Oh yeah, there you're getting all the senses involved now too.
Just very amazing. Just stimulation.
Wow. And so, did it work? Listening to the Boyz II Men, you think? Do you feel like that kind of laid some groundwork, helping you with ladies?
I think it was the glow in the dark stars.
Take notes at home. The glow-in-the-dark stars.
I think a lava lamp, too.
I just got in the lava lamps. I have two now. They're kind of like quasi-pets, like a pet rock type level commitment. You got to take care of them a little bit. You got to, like,
water
them. You got to walk. You got to make sure they grow. Oh, my gosh. It's like a whole thing.
These youngins that are watching are like, what in the hell are they talking about?
Oh my gosh! Oh yeah, we're getting some fun interaction too.
We got a viewer question from Keebs, I think that's how you say it. They want to know, what's your favorite part about doing music?
Probably the songwriting. I love performing for the most part, but the songwriting is what I've originally started, and it's. To me, it's my favorite thing because you wouldn't have music if there wasn't songwriting. So it's music at its simplest form, and that's just my favorite thing. I just love writing songs, going on writing retreats, renting a cabin like by a river somewhere up in North Georgia, and bringing some buddies down there, and you just down there for 3 days, and you're just writing, and there's no rules, and that's what I like about it the most, because there's no rules, and I don't like rules.
Yeah, yes, absolutely. Oh my gosh. Well, keep the questions coming, chat. If you got questions, you drop them. Michael's looking at them. I'm looking at them here when I get the chance. Also, keep us going to 5:30. I don't know if we're at that many subscribers yet, but
we're at
519. We're 519. We're growing every second.
We actually have another quick question.
This from Tash Kostner. What inspired you to sing country music specifically?
Back, I was probably 16, and my mom married George Jones's lead guitar player, Dwayne Phillips, and he had played with George Jones for, probably 20 years, a long time. And I went on the road with George and for a summer, like with my stepdad, and rode the tour bus and got to see all of it. And after hearing him sing and just the way he told stories, and I just fell in love with it, to be honest. Like, it was, I knew that's kind of what I wanted to do. I didn't know how I was going to do it, but that's the first thing that really set me into loving country music and wanting to do music, and the fact that it was just something that I could do since I was little. And it was, you know, you try to make a living doing what you're best at, and that's what I was the best at. Actually, that's all I can do, so that I had to have a choice.
There you go. Yeah, I wanted to talk about kind of your like background with music. You were singing at a young age. What was like your earliest memories with music? Like, when was like the earliest point where you would like confidently be like, oh yeah, I was like singing, or like I would have considered myself a musician at that point?
Well, I don't know if I'd have considered myself a musician at this early age, but I mean, I remember I would just try to imitate, you know, singers on TV. I'd be standing in front of the TV and try to imitate and sing like them. And I loved everything from Michael Jackson to, like I said, Boyz II Men to rap, hip hop, rock. And I was just, it was something I was just could do at an age. I knew I could sing. Now, when I started, my mom realized that I could sing, and she saw that it came pretty easy to me. She got me involved in classical training. She got me into voice lessons from this lady just a town over, and I started taking classical voice lessons and started singing classical music. And I didn't think it was cool. I knew it wasn't cool. I knew my friends were going to make fun of me, but I was good at it, and you know, ended up going to college for a vocal performance and classical music. So.
Oh wow! And so you mentioned that you like quote unquote didn't think it was very cool, or like you knew your friends maybe wouldn't have thought it was so cool, but obviously, I mean, there must have been something that resonated with just being able to sing and kind of have that outlet.
Yeah, it was probably wasn't the coolest, but like, I shouldn't say all my friends made fun of me because they thought I was good and, you know, won't like to hear me sing. So, and I'm a people pleaser, and it was just one of the things, like, I like to entertain people, and so if I can sing and they enjoy it and they smile and get a kick out of it, then that's what I love to do, and I just kept doing it.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, it's so cool too, reading about kind of your background with music and specifically your background with singing, because now with your country music, I mean, it's not really stylistically the same as classical singing, but it's clear that you have like just an extraordinary control over your voice and ability to kind of use it to do all these really cool things. Like sometimes you'll hit like a fill in a song where it goes really high and like my jaw drops to the floor. It's so cool. And so I guess like that was probably just wildly helpful to be able to kind of lay all of that foundation, or even like singing with like a choir, harmonizing with people.
Yeah, I did like all national choirs and did old state choir and all that stuff. And it did help getting all that education on that, knowing how to sing classical music, because classical music's one of the toughest things to sing on the planet, just period. Just because, you know, control and controlling your vibrato, you learn how to control that. You learn how to use your voice like a tool, so you're not just singing the same. Like I can, not that I need to, obviously, but I can make my voice raspier in some songs, or, you know, smooth it out. And it just gave me a lot more vocal control because I was having to use that when singing classical. And then stuff like learning how to breathe from the diaphragm. That helps me on the road so you don't ruin your voice, you know, because you're out there week after week. If you don't know how to sing correctly and do that, you can potentially really hurt your voice, mess up your voice. So it did pay off to have some of those lessons.
Yeah, absolutely. Wow. I want to ask too about now when you went to college, you studied opera, right? That is really interesting to me too, just because I love opera.
It wasn't opera. It's classical.
Kind of like just
classical. It was vocal performance. So it was like with the choir and the, but yeah, I mean, same type of stuff.
Yeah. Oh my gosh. If you did then, or if you still do now, do you listen to a lot of like classical music or that kind of stuff?
Some, like Andre Bocelli, I listen to a lot of him. He's one of the best singers on the planet. I've been on a Sinatra kick. That's not classical, but it's got a similar hint of that in there. But yeah, I've been on a Sinatra kick until I was driving home after a write the other day, and I about fell asleep because that Sinatra stuff, if you don't get going, it can put you in. You're like, fly me to the moon. Oh, God. AC/DC. You bet.
There you go. You're like, I need to get out of this smoky 1940s bar.
Man, yeah.
I need to wake up. Oh, my gosh.
Joe, we got another question.
Oh, yes, another question.
From Rosa Beats, they want to know which artists were on repeat when you were writing Redneck Crazy album.
Which artists?
Yeah, like, I'm guessing which artists were you listening to while you were writing that album, the Help Out.
Oh, okay. Let's see. I'm going to have to go back in the archives here. well, it wasn't that long. I mean, it was like 7 years, 8 years ago, so acting like it was 20 years ago.
Hey, it's been a long few years.
You ain't telling me nothing. That would have been, I would say, Jason Aldean. As bad as I hate to admit that, I liked this record. Because I didn't know I was going to be friends with them. I wasn't friends with them at the time, so I feel like an idiot. but I was. I forget what album. I think that's around about when the Truth came out, his song, one of my favorite songs that he had. And I just really love that song, so I wore that out. When else was probably... And this never changes, so I've listened to this since I was young, but Hank Jr. is like just stays on rotation of like every album it is, so it just kind of goes on shuffle. So a lot of Hank. I mean, I've always been a fan of the traditional country.
Oh, yeah.
So just that type of stuff, you know, Vern Gosnan to Conway Twitty to Jones and Haggard, all that stuff. I want to say at that time, too, I was listening to a lot of Blake Shelton. I forget what. It's hard for me to remember what songs were like out then. But I was a big fan of Blake. And that's all I can give you, because it'd take some research to figure out what songs were out then.
That is enough to make a playlist. On Spotify, you got a few artists in there. You could have kind of like a redneck, crazy influences playlist.
Then Tupac and Biggie, they stay in rotation too, along with Bone Thugs and Harmony. So
yes, all right. Well, so I want to ask now, kind of focusing in, you know, learning about your narrative and kind of your journey as an artist. You mentioned earlier how George Jones and kind of that whole experience with your father was a really kind of big moment in terms of kind of coming to country music and deciding that's what you want to do. What were kind of like the next steps after that like? Like, did you start writing country songs? What did all that look like?
So, after that, I started, I picked up a guitar and started playing guitar. My mom would put me in guitar lessons, and that didn't, I'm just not good with lessons on anything. But I didn't like taking guitar lessons. So my stepdad, he taught me, a few chords. So I just learned the kind of the basics, and then I would be on my dial up AOL in my bedroom with my screen that was about that big around, that made noises when it started booted up and whatnot, Googling songs, and I'd look up the chords and just kind of self-taught and just kind of learned how to play them. And then I wrote a few songs. They're terrible, absolutely terrible. Trust me, I don't know. Just take my word for it, they're awful.
That's a really dangerous thing to say when you're holding the guitar in your hand and I could ask if I could hear them.
Well, I can't remember them to play them to you, but I have them written down at home, and trust me, they are terrible. I was writing a little bit, not like on a weekly basis. Went to college, like I was saying, on a vocal performance scholarship. Did that for 2 years, 3 years. And it just wasn't real fulfilling for me. And I just literally packed up and moved to Nashville one day with my stuff. Just came to Nashville.
Hear about that story, because I read a little bit about it. And so you didn't even tell your parents?
No.
And you just came down. And you ended up working at Tootsie's as a bouncer?
Yeah, so my first job, I was passing out flyers for Tootsie's during, it was fanfare at the time, in a full-blown suit, like walking up and down Broadway passing out flyers. That was back when Nashville had a skyline.
Yeah, like a full suit on?
Yeah.
You probably looked like a Frank Sinatra fan.
Oh, I was sweating like Elvis, and I was dressed like Frank Sinatra, but it was hot. I remember that. Well, I started doing that, and then I got a gig. They gave me a gig working the door and bouncing, and did that for and flipping burgers and everything else. And then after that, I ended up getting to get up on stage and sing, and started playing gigs down there 4 nights a week.
Wow. What was that kind of like once you got into that headspace? I mean, did you feel like you were finally doing something that you really wanted to do? Was it like really fulfilling?
Yeah, I mean, I thought I was in the right direction. I was, didn't know it then, but I was honing skills that, I'd use down the road, just entertaining and learning how people react to different things you say and how to make up a set list and where up tempos need to go and where ballads go and what gets people excited when you're performing. And so it basically just, it cut my teeth for, paved the road for later success. But that's when I started playing it, that's when I really started songwriting and really doing it regularly. Still wasn't, I wouldn't say professional yet, or if there is a profession, but that after Tootsie's, that's when I really started to get good at writing and really started honing my skills on that.
All right, yeah. Were you collaborating with others at that time, or were you still mostly kind of woodshopping on your own?
I was starting to, write with other people. I end up getting, Red Akins, Dallas Davis, and Ben Haislip, the Peach Pickers, Rhett's the one that, really got me started and heard this demo I made and wanted to work with me. So I got to writing with them first, and that's when I started getting better and better at songwriting, because I was around guys that did it for a living. And from writing with them, I would watch them and, just really learn a lot from them, take it in, and years go by, and I'm writing with more people than just them, and just getting better at it just by doing it. Not everybody can write songs, but if you can, you still have to do it and do it and do it to get better and, live life and mess up a bunch to have something to even write about. So.
There you go. Oh, my gosh. Yeah, okay, so I don't want to, put you on the spot, especially since stuff like this can kind of be a little heady to explain, but are there any particular, tips or things that you learned during that time that you felt like were, particularly helpful in your own songwriting?
Um, I just learned to be real, like to put, like, don't write something that is not real to you, because more than likely it's not going to be real to everyone else, and people will see through that. Because so I'm learned to, when I'm writing, and maybe there's a couple co-writers that say this, and they're, you know, and to speak up, because it's like don't be shy, and I was never shy. If you don't like something, say it. It doesn't matter if this person's written a million number ones or whatever. Your name's on a song too, so I was decent at speaking up for my standing my own ground, and just really, if something I didn't think something fit or wasn't real to true to me, then I would be pretty good at not putting it in the song because it just didn't feel right.
Yeah, absolutely. Wow. Well, now kind of moving into like the next really kind of big moment in your career, Redneck Crazy. I want to ask specifically about that song. What can you kind of tell us about the story about it? Where did it come from? Where did you kind of...
Well, that, I didn't write Redneck Crazy, and everyone thinks I did. I don't know if that's a compliment. I don't think it is. But the good news is I really didn't throw beer cans at my ex's window. So you're welcome, America. I'm not a psychopath. I didn't write it, but I did back in the day. I did have a girl, ex-girlfriend, obviously. I'm married now. I don't know why I said ex. I'm married. I'm like,
you're married to her now?
No, I'm not. No, I'm so married sad. Now. So,
oh, yeah, okay.
A past girlfriend, old girlfriend.
Past girlfriend.
That cheated on me, and like I found out and stuff, and actually saw the dude's truck in her drive and all that whole nine yards. And so I went through it, and some friends and people that were close to me, like in the publishing industry, and by then I had a publishing deal, kind of knew that that had happened. And I just, you know, got a record deal and stuff, and a plugger that knew kind of that I was going through a breakup, my girlfriend cheated on me. She knew the story and heard one of her writers wrote this song. She's like, no one will ever cut this, and I don't even know if anyone else could pull this off besides you, but you need to come hear the song. And I went over and listened to it, and I was like, yeah, that's great. So that's how that came about. So it is partially true. I didn't write it, but it's still, songs still have to fit me. Like, I'm not going to lie through my teeth and put a song out.
Yeah, totally. Wow. What was it like once that record came out and you kind of got the response it got?
It was awesome because I wasn't used to people showing up at my shows and, you know, used to seeing lines in front of clubs and stuff. And it was just kind of surreal, to be honest. Nothing really like prepares you for that because it's a, I mean, I'm sure people say, I knew I was going to make it. I never knew I was going to make it. These other artists, they say that. Maybe they did. They're just arrogant as hell. But I'm so great. Look at, I'm going to make it. No, nothing's guaranteed. So, no, I never thought I was going to make it. And I just loved doing it. And all of a sudden, it just happened. And then the next thing I know, I'm standing on stage. And it's just kind of surreal because people are singing every word of the song. I'm like, what the, you know, it's a weird feeling because you just don't expect that. That's what you're striving for. You still don't expect it. So it was pretty surreal.
Yeah, absolutely. Wow.
We got a question.
Yeah. Hit us, Michael.
Rosa Beats wants to know, has hunting inspired any of your music?
Oh yeah. Yeah. 100%. When I'm, hunting, sitting in the woods, you know, a lot of times I'll put down ideas and titles. And it's just, when I'm doing that, it allows me time to think. So it does inspire. In fact, you know, I do even write while I'm hunting because I'm writing down ideas, titles, and it's because it's quiet and you can think. So it definitely inspires a lot about me. And hunting stories from just experiences in the woods. And a lot of songs I write, you can hear that in there. So.
Yeah, absolutely. I believe that we're going to be going to an ad break shortly, but before we do, I want to ask you one question first, and then we're going to come back with some more music and some more questions. And so if you have questions at home, I'm going to remind you again that you can be asking them. But we love to talk about specific songs. We love to kind of like open the hood. Another song from your career that happened kind of in between Redneck Crazy and now is, oh gosh, let me find what I wrote down here. Guy Walks Into the Bar. That's what I want to know about. What can you tell us about that tune and kind of how that came to be?
That song, Guy Walks Into a Bar, was a song I actually passed on that song in a pitch meeting because it was a demo and it was like really produced. All the tracks and everything were up real high, and I just didn't hear it and passed on it. And I was in pitch meetings all day, and then after they were over, I went to Winner's bar in Midtown, because I was thirsty, and sat at the bar and had a whiskey or two, and they were doing like a writer's round thing. It was three songwriters up there, and I knew a few of them, or a couple of them, and they're just going, one's playing a song, you know, going down like they do, and Jonathan Singleton was up there and starts playing a song, and I was like, dang, I kind of turned around and it was Guy Walks Into a Bar, even though I just passed it. I was like, I know that song. I think I heard that in a pitch meeting, but this was just raw when it was him and the guitar, and I was like, I got to cut that. And I went up to his publisher was standing next to him. I said, I want to cut that, and that's going to be my next single. And he's like, hell yeah, you know. And it was. It was the next single, and I did well. So it's one of my favorite songs to play live.
Oh, my gosh. That's such a great Nashville story, too. That's so cool.
Yeah.
Whoa. Well, we're going to be going to an ad break shortly. Right now, actually. But we're going to be back with some music from Tyler Farr, some more questions. Keep your fan questions coming in, chat, and subscribe if you haven't already. We'll be back shortly. Hello, and welcome back to Off the Record Live. Now we're going to have a real treat. Tyler, you're going to be playing a few songs for us.
Yeah.
What songs are you going to be playing?
The first one I'm going to do is Cover Girl. It's for everyone that's heard it, and if you've heard it, I'm not sure if you have or not, but it was a song I wrote with a couple buddies of mine, and it being Domestic Violence Awareness Month. It's a important song to a lot of people. I get a lot of messages about it, and it addresses domestic violence, and that's an important thing to address because it happens a lot in our country, and there's not a lot of songs that really talk about that, and I wanted to write something that women out there could maybe get some release and let go of, and just get something from the song, maybe a little healing or whatever. And it's a lot of people, it's touched them, and they've reached out to me, and it's pretty amazing to hear all the how much it meant to them, this and that. So it's just a cool song, an important song for me.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, I'd love to hear
it. I am hunkered over in this chair, so I will try to project. This is not a singing friendly chair.
No. We're going to get through.
Remember the classical training I was telling you about?
Yeah, there you go.
This is not where how you're supposed to sit when you're singing.
Take notes at home.
Yeah. She let her last tear drop, pressed the pedal down, put them in a review, along with that stuck here town. Turn that FM down till she found a song to help forget what was already gone.
So damn tired of concealing. No real man should ever lay his hands on you. Hey, cover girl, cover girl. They meant to cover black and blue. Flying down the road, crossing county lines. You never thought she'd leave, but you did this time. You never felt so free, never thought she'd know what it feels like to break the chains and roll. Go on, girl, go. Cover, girl. Isn't supposed to cover, girl. Makeup hides, but don't hit it. So damn tired of concealing. No real man should ever lay his hands on you. Hey, cover girl, cover girl. Ain't meant to cover black and blue. Keep on rolling, don't slow down. Don't let the devil pull you back around. You're almost there. Keep moving and prove it. Cover girl. It's supposed to cover, girl. Makeup hides, but don't heal it. So damn tired of concealing. No real man should ever lay his hands on you. Makeup, girl. They meant to cover black and blue. Meant to cover black and blue. Hey, cover girl, I meant to cover black and blue. There you go, thank you.
Well, I believe that you got another song for us. What else are you gonna play?
I'm gonna do Y'all Walks in the Bar, and I already told you that story.
All right, so I hope you're paying attention at home.
If not, you're out of luck, Jack. Let's see. I'm telling you, I'm sunkered over here trying to. And this chair goes really well with high songs too, because you really want to be squished over when you're singing real high and projecting. I might pull a hamstring, but bear with me.
And it'll happen here live on Twitch.
I'll see if I remember this. I haven't played it since last night, so. The joke's on me, and it ain't funny. Everybody and me see the punchline coming my way. I've heard it so many times, I could tell it to the T, believe me, I could sell it all day. It goes, a guy walks into a bar, orders a drink, sees a girl that catches his eye, ask her if she wants another, offer each other and end up lovers, laugh, cry, hold on tight, may work for a little while. Then one out of ten lights fade out into the dark. And a guy walks into a bar. I'd left too if my heart had let me. Keeping it light probably helped to get me over you. I'm walking, talking, drinking proof. Cliche in that corner booth, it ain't nothing new. A guy walks into a bar, orders a drink, sees a girl that catches his eye, ask her if she wants another, offer each other
and end up a lover's life. Cry, hold on tight, they work for a little while. Then one night, tail lights fade out into the dark. A guy walks into a bar. He's a girl that catches his eye. Ask her if she wants another. Hover each other and end up a lover's life. Cry, hold on tight, make it work for a little while. Then one night, tail lights fade out into the dark. A guy walks into a bar. A guy walks into a bar.
That was what we call the alternate ending. If you give me an acoustic guitar and I don't have my band, I just feel free so I can do whatever the hell I want. So sometimes I'll go to this chord, I can go to this chord. I can add chords and I can add lyrics.
Wow, it's free. You can add any. You can even do a different song.
America.
That's right. Oh my gosh. Wow. Well, that was amazing. We're going to be going to another ad break, and then we're going to be back with some more questions. Keep them coming in the chat. Keep subscribing. Hang out with us. Thank you so much. We're going to be back. Hello and welcome back to Off the Record Live. We're here with Tyler Farr, who just played two great songs. That was awesome.
Thank you.
I want to talk about the first one you played, Cover Girl, which is your new single that's out right now. I know that you just told us a bit of kind of like the story and the background of the song, but I want to dig in a little. And specifically, I'm curious because I read online that you initially wrote down like Cover Girl as a title around 5 years ago. What was kind of the journey? And like, do you often have, there's like a lot of titles sitting around? Like, is that something you do often? And then I'm giving you a lot of questions here, so the floor will be yours.
That's all right, I got a large brain.
And then basically, when you got into like the writing room, how did the song kind of evolve into taking on like the really meaningful meaning that it has now?
So I, oftentimes I will think of an idea or be watching a movie or reading a book or magazine. And yes, I can read. I know that was a question on there. I'll get an idea or title and I'll write it, you know, under my notes in my phone, and come back to it another day. And that was like, it was kind of what happened with Cover Girl. I was, believe in an airport and was, reading a magazine and it had a, there was a Cover Girl ad, you know, for the makeup. And, in my mind, being as weird as it is, for some reason, it's like, man, that would be a cool song title. That's a cool song title. I don't know what I would really write it about, but I put it in my phone. And then down the road, later when I actually got in the writing room with Ben Stennis and Blake Bollinger, the other writers on it, we were sitting in my garage and on the couches and kind of where I write, and I was going, kind of reading, well, should we do this, kind of throwing out ideas, and that's what you do when you're starting to write. You kind of, someone may throw out an idea, and you just, until you finally all agree on an idea, and you can, it's just, you kind of feel it. It's not like it was, okay, I'm cool with that. You can kind of tell when someone's not into something, so you keep throwing them out there, and I got down to that one, and we all three really like the idea or the title, and we automatically kind of just naturally went to a song like Cover Girl, like we ended up writing it. We automatically kind of went there first together. We just didn't know how we were going to write it. But once we kind of got talking about it, we all had something, you know, in common with domestic violence in some way, shape, or form. Whether a family member that had been through that and been in that situation, or we all had some tie into domestic violence, and then it's unfortunately we did, and it happens a lot. So a lot of people, it affects more than just the victim. It affects the families, kids, and my tie into it was I used to be a real rehabilitate, worked at a children's rehabilitation facility at Lake of the Ozarks in Missouri, where I'm from, and it was for kids with affect disorder, trauma, all sorts of things like that. And I was a recreational therapist there for a summer. And that was probably my second favorite job I've ever had. I loved it, but that was, these kids were, 99% of them were all raised in homes that had domestic violence happen. And that stayed with them for life. And this is really sad. And that's where I really could relate to that topic, because I got to see the effects it has on children's and on families, on just all the way around. It just trickles down. That's a big slope. And we just kind of went there. And my main thing was, and like you were asking me, what do I try to do when I'm songwriting, or what's a pointer you could give to someone? And I said, being real. Well, this is a prime example of that. Because we started to write it, and I was like, no, that's too fluffy. I'm like, let's just go. Because it's pretty vivid at parts in that song that say, no romance should ever lay his hands on you. I mean, that's just saying you don't hit women. You're just saying it because you don't. And, we were kind of like, is that a little too blunt? When we got through the song, and I'm like, man, it just needs to be raw. It needs to be real, so people will feel something. And that's what we did. And after we wrote it, I knew that we had written something special. May never be a number one, may never sell a bunch of copies, but I know it's helped a lot of people because they've reached out to me, and that's why I do what I do.
Yeah, and I'm sure that's got to be one of the most beautiful parts of writing a song like this, and then also one of the most surreal parts of just being in the position you're in as a music maker, is to be able to put something out in the world like this and then see the responses. I mean, even just watching the video on YouTube before I came in, that you can go through the comments, and there's just so many people who are reaching out and saying that the song was meaningful for them.
And that's like I said, that's our job as a songwriter, so that makes me feel like I did my job. So that makes me happy.
Yeah, oh, that's so beautiful, wow. So when did you kind of put together this tune? Was this something that you were working on during the pandemic?
No, this was 2 years ago. Roughly 2 years ago. And it was, 2 years ago.
It was 2 years ago,
folks. It was 2 years ago.
There you go. What, on that note, what was your pandemic experience like? Your wife is an ICU nurse, correct?
Yeah, she's a critical, she's not a critical care nurse now. She stopped doing critical care nursing after we had our first child. But she still is a nurse. But up to all of last year, she was a critical care nurse. So she got to see the hard stuff there in the hospital.
Wow. And so what was that kind of like for you, even kind of settling into such a turbulent time globally and also having that kind of energy in your home too?
Man, I've got to ask that a lot. People, how did COVID affect your life? I'm like, I shot more turkey, killed more deer. So I just lost a lot of money and didn't get to play shows. And they shut everything down. That's how it affected me. And what it did is pissed me off, because I wanted to be out there playing shows. And I love my fans. That's why I do what I do. And we couldn't do it. And it was just like, I'm like, I got to get out of this house. My wife's going to murder me. She's like, please go somewhere and do something. Go to China. Take a trip to, Paraguay. I don't know. But that's... And we got, part of it was, I got to be with her while she was pregnant, and I was cooking up homemade soups and stuff and Googling. I'm making homemade chicken pot pies to own white wine sauce and pasta. I mean, and it was like the kitchen. My wife doesn't, she loves my cooking and I can cook, but she doesn't like when I cook because of the aftermath that sets in, because there's baking powder over here, starch over here, cups of sugar. I mean, it looks like World War II. So I did that's what I did, and it I made the baby during COVID, and
there you go,
helped my wife along her pregnancy as much as I could. So it sucked, don't get me wrong, last year sucked, but there was a lot of good that came out of it too, is what I'm saying. And I do is hunt and fish and write songs and play songs. So the only thing I still wrote, but I had so much time, like when it's COVID started, I'm like, this is awesome. I can turkey hunt all day, every day. I ain't got to do nothing besides just go around and shoot turkeys in the face and eat them. This is amazing. So my house was like a lodge for the entire season of turkey. My wife was about to kill my buddies. Buddies come up from Georgia, and they were staying at the house for like 2 weeks. My wife's like, what exactly? Are you running an outfitting service or what? So it was good. I got to hunt a lot and spend time with friends that I don't normally get to see, because I'm on the road a lot. So it was good. But yeah, that it didn't really change my day-to-day activity, but it just took away any travel and playing for the fans, and that got old really quickly. And I soon found myself not saying, oh, this is awesome, I get to turkey hunt every day. I'm like, I gotta go on the road, this has got to end.
Oh my gosh, how has becoming a father kind of changed your life? Has it changed your artistry at all, like your songwriting or anything?
Yeah, you know, it gives I look at a songwriter that, like, he has lanes, like, based on the experiences he's been through. I'm 37, but I'd like to say I think I've lived a lot longer than 37. But you can only write real about what you know, or else it's not real. I mean, if you don't know anything about it, you're just BSing, but you have... See, I have this lane. I can write about heartbreak. So, see what I mean by lane? So this gave me a whole nother lane that I've never really been able to write about and feel comfortable about, because I didn't know anything about it because I've never had a kid. I've had, like, bird dogs, but way hairier. So it really got me. I just wrote a song recently called Questions, and it's about my daughter, a beautiful song, and it's just kind of opened up a whole, you just put you in another place, and I can write down that lane from a father now. And it's weird, once you're a father, you hear, like, you know, In My Daughter's Eyes, or hear, you know, dad songs, excluding Mr. Mom. You really feel something now because you're there. So it's just a whole nother side.
Yeah, absolutely. Oh, that's great. Here, I'm going to check our chat real quick. I'm seeing that we got some things coming in. Like,
I have a question for the fans. How many of y'all know the song Mr. Mom by Lone Star? If you don't have it downloaded, go download it.
Y'all heard it here. I'm gonna go download it after this, because I regrettably don't know it.
Do not download it.
Never mind.
Never download that, ever. I'm pretty sure none of my buddies wrote it. Oh, well, don't download it.
We have some
it.
Folks
awful.
Raising hands, saying me. There we go. Oh, we got a question from Queen K, 2021, who asked, what's your favorite book?
There, no one on earth is going to believe this whenever I say it. The book I'm reading right now is The Iliad and the Odyssey.
Yeah, all right, Homer.
Didn't see that one coming, did you? My favorite book is The Old Man and the Boy. It's a really good book. It's about this kid learned all these life lessons from his grandfather. It's like a kind of old Southern book. And he's just like taking him hunting and fishing and stuff, and all these life lessons this kid learns. Pretty much how to be a man from his grandfather taking him around and teaching him lessons about life. And it's a great book, and it's, I forget how many copies are sold, but it's pretty popular. Probably not with the young whippersnappers these days, but and also while we're on the books, I have read every single Harry Potter book.
All right, every single
one. Didn't see that one coming either, did you?
Well, when did you read the books? Like when they were coming out, or?
It was like, gosh, it was, that'd be after college. Like, I'm not sure when they come out. It was after when the movies were coming out, and maybe the book, yeah.
What Hogwarts house are you?
I'm definitely, what's the good one? There's Slytherin.
Gryffindor?
Gryffindor, for sure. Well, I got a little bit of Slytherin in me, too. I don't know. I don't think they have a house that really fits. Is there a redneck?
Yeah, I'm thinking the same thing. It kind of, there's something about like the Scottishness of Hogwarts. It doesn't match the redneck kind of country ethos.
Yeah, like my broom that I'm riding would have to have some mud grips on it.
Do you know what? We should reach out to J.K. Rowling and see if we can get like an extended universe Nashville Wizardry School.
You need to be equal. I need my broom to have a 6-inch Pro Comp lift on it with Super Swamper tires. We're excluding all the rednecks out of Hogwarts, and I'm your guys' biggest fan.
That's right. Oh my gosh, wow. Well, we're pretty much at time here, but I got just one last kind of wrap-up question for you today, which is, you've got the single out, you've got some cool stuff in the works now. How do you feel? What's the future look like for you?
I don't know what the future holds. I've been writing some of, I think, some of the best stuff I've ever written. I think better than, and I've had some success, but I honestly think this last year, especially the last 8 months, I've written some of the best songs. And I think I got some big songs in there. So now we just got to put them out and give them to you beautiful people.
That's right. You beautiful people, they're coming your way sometime soon. Tyler Farr, thank you so much for taking the time out of your day and speaking with us. It's been a real joy. And everyone at home, I want to thank you too for tuning in and watching this and supporting us. If you haven't subscribed yet, please subscribe. Yeah, share it with your friends. Tell anyone you know who loves music or wants to ask questions to songwriters and music makers. We're doing these kind of often, like once a week-ish, something like that. And so there's going to be more opportunities. So please, keep supporting us. Keep making this the great community it is. Thank you to American Songwriter. Thank you to Twitch. Thank you to Neon Media for having us at their studios. Thanks to everyone in the world.
Jesus.
Thanks, Jesus. Thank you, Tyler Farr. I'm Joe Vito. Thank you for watching. This has been Off the Record. Have a good one.